in terms of torque. So with this, we concluded the trajectory planning, and so we miss only a couple of arguments to complete all the theoretical content of this course before to move on more practical, let me say, on the elaborate. The first one is an introduction, not to say superficial, because it's not superficial, but high from a high point of view, a general introduction about the actuators and the sensors that you can find inside in a real robot manipulator that typically you can have to cope with. So I will provide you some information about possible joint actuation systems, servo motors, sensors, and both in terms of proprioceptive sensors, that are sensors that are used to measure the state, internal state of the robot, and exteroceptive sensors, that are sensors that are needed to measure quantities that are in the workspace of the manipulator, that is related to the task. If I want to grasp an object, someone has to give me an information where is the object, which is the shape of the object, if there are obstacles along the path, and so on. Okay, such kind of information are related to exteroceptive sensors. If I want to know which is my configuration, I need the position of each joint, and this is an information that is of my state, so it's a proprioceptive sensor, and so on. Okay. We can start from the joint actuation system. What is a joint actuation system? It is composed by a number of subsystems that compose each, from a physical point of view, a joint of a robot manipulator. Okay? And in a manipulator we have N joints. Okay, this is a representation of each one of these joints. So typically a joint actuation system is composed by a power supply, and we will see which kind of power supply depends on the nature of the joint. Could be, if the motor is electric, here is electric power. If it's pneumatic or it's hydraulic, here we have a different kind of a power supply system. Then we typically have a power amplifier. A power amplifier received a command from the control unit of the robot manipulator that depends on the trajectory that we generated and the state of the system. And obviously what the work of this power amplifier is that it takes the shape of the motion that you want to achieve, and by using the power provided by the power supply generate a power signal, so with energy, that has the same shape of the command with the energy provided by the power supply. And this will be provided to the servo motor. The servo motor is the system that physically generated the motion, that applied the torque, for example, to the system. This motor, or servo motor in general, typically is not directly connected to the link, to the joint, but between the servo motor and the link, typically we have a transmission system. It's like in your car, you have the engine, but the engine is not directly connected to the wheel, but it is a gear, no? For example. And there is a transmission system because typically the rotation axis of your motor is not aligned with the rotation axis of the wheel, so you need to transmit the motion and to change in some way this motion, the characteristic of this motion, okay? And similar things can happen also in a robot manipulator for several reasons that we will analyze in a while. So we start from the transmission. So typically a joint motion in a robot manipulator is happen at low speed with high torques, okay? Because typically the movement of a robot is that the joints rotate with low speed, no? But we need high torques because there are heavy objects. The robot itself is heavier, 1 ton, 100 kilograms to up to 1 ton, and so on. So only just to stay in a configuration, we have to lift heavier pieces of joints and so on. Then there is the, I don't know if you saw, there are robots that just move an entire frame of a car. No? Very big, so very heavy. So we need high torque and we move with low velocities. Okay, this is what we need. But not often the motors and the actuation system that we have has the same characteristics. Okay, so we have to match different words by using a transmission system. Okay, so we can have spur gears, lead screws, and timing belts are the most common transmission systems that we can find in general in a mechanical system and also in a robot manipulator. So spur gears change the axis of rotation and or translate the application point. Okay, it depends how you concatenate these spur gears. Typically, these are constructed with wide cross section because we have to transmit high torque, so are bolt, and squat shaft, okay, because we have to transmit a big torque. Lead screws typically convert rotational motion of a typical motor into a translational motion that is required to generate a prismatic joint, typically. Timing, okay, and this also can be also used to reduce friction, and to use this, there are ball screws, so, but it's more mechanical practice, so that is not really so interesting for us. And the last one is the timing belt. So timing belt can help us to locate the motor remotely with respect to the axis of actuation of the joint. So we can relocalize the motor far from the actuation point. Typically, this works good in a good way at high speed and low forces. Okay? Otherwise, we can use a chain instead of a timing belt. A chain, instead, it's metallic typically, can again locate the motor far from the actuation point, but this can work at low speed. We cannot use a chain at high speed because we inject a lot of vibrations. Okay, but it's very stiff, and so there is no deformation and so on, so it can work with lower velocity. Another remote possibility is to have a direct drive, so a direct coupling of motor on directly on the joint. This never happened at the end in a robot manipulator. One, for example, but you can see example of this in a gimbal. I don't know if you know camera gimbals, no? Also the hand one or the one that are on drones. In that case, it's a direct drive actuation. The motor is actuated directly the axis. But in that case, you have a very poor torques. In fact, you have to balance a lot your system because if the camera is unbalanced, your system goes in protection. There is no torque to move. It's just working inertia. Okay, you have just to, you have not to, it cannot able to work statically because there are no torque, but it can generate higher acceleration because all the acceleration of the motor is directly applied to the joint. So, and this is useful to compensate, for example, motion of the hand and so on. But in robotics, is not common, this, absolutely not common. So the servo motors, that is next block from the right to the left. Typically, we can find servo motors of three main types, genres, that are pneumatic motors, hydraulic motors, or electrical motors. Now, pneumatic motors generate motion by using pneumatic energy that is typically stored, generated by a compressor somewhere and with a tank that accumulates such energy. And then we can generate a motion using a piston or a turbine. A piston if you want to generate a linear motion, or a turbine to generate a rotational motion. Hydraulic motors similarly as before, but now we have hydraulic energy that is stored typically in a big tank with the typically a motor that generate the pressure inside this tank. Okay, electrical motors, I think that you know quite well what we are speaking about. So, which kind of motors we need? So we need the motors with low inertia and high power to weight ratio. Low inertia because we want to accelerate quickly in a way to have a higher controllability in our system. And we need a high power to weight ratio because the motors has to be distributed along the kinematic chain. So if the motor is heavier, it means that the motor before needs to be bigger, so heavier as well. So the motors before again has to be bigger and so on, and so we have enormous motors. So we need the best on the market motors with the power to weight ratio, typically, that are able to have also a low inertia on the shaft. We need the possibility to overload and deliver impulsive torques. This is a typically motion that we generate in a pick and place, for example, robot, no? Impulse, because when we change a direction, we have to apply enormous torque, but for few milliseconds, because we have just to change the direction. So it means that we need to have the possibility to overload the motor. Overload means that we cannot stay with this high torque forever, okay? But so this is the rudder. So if you want to stay with, so it means the gravity, okay, we can reach a certain torque level. But such a motor can be overloaded to generate dynamics. That is a variable impulsive like torque. So this allow us the capability to develop high accelerations. Typically, we need the actuation system that can work with wide velocity range because we can move very slowly to perform a precise task, or fast if we have to perform a sequence, a repetitive sequence of a task, and so on. We need high positioning accuracy, at least 1/1,000 of a circle, and a low torque ripple in a way to not generate noise and the vibration in the system. So a servo motor is typically used to generate a trajectory tracking. So we assign a trajectory and we want that the robot is able to execute with low error the trajectory that we plan. Because if we plan something, the robot do another things, we are, obviously it does not work. So we need a servo motor that has a very low error in terms of trajectory following. And we also need the capability of the system that once we reach a steady state, a point, the accuracy is very high at that point. Okay, so we need a dynamic low error. We can accept, but limited during the dynamics, depending on the task. But once that we reach a position, that is the position to grasp tangents, to drill, and so on, the position should be very accurate. Okay. Now, electrical servo motors are typically built with DC, direct current servo motors. Typically, brushless motors are used in this, for this kind of applications. Sometimes also stepper motor, but the more diffused, absolutely the more diffused one, are brushless DC servo motor. It is the most diffused type of actuation system that is used. Hydraulic servo motors are also sometimes used, but typically for bigger, very for robots that has to lift enormous weights. Okay, so hydraulic servo motors are used for giant robots. Okay, in construction sector or stuff like that, and typically so where electrical motors are not able to. So the maximum lift of a robot with electrical motor that I know is the Titan of KUKA that has a payload of 1 tons. Okay, if you want to go over, there is no more electrical motors that you can use. You need other kind of stuff like hydraulic systems. There are some advantages and disadvantages. So big disadvantage of hydraulic servo motors is that are quite dirty because there are oil. You need a big costly plant to generate this kind of energy. The advantage is that if you want to stay statically, an electrical motor, you are consuming energy even to stay stopped because you need the energy to compensate the gravity. With the hydraulic motor, no, you just close a valve and you stay stopped. So there is no energy consumption in a steady state configuration. So there are some pros and cons. Typically, the dynamics of the hydraulic servo motor are poor with respect to the electrical motor. Electrical motors are very precise in trajectory following. Hydraulic servo motors, not so much. Plus or minus at the steady state, yes. Plus or minus, not as a, but in dynamics, the trajectory that you execute is not so accurate. Okay, especially if the power increases a lot. Because the control of the valve is a non-linear system, it's very complex and it's not so accurate. Also, the fluid is a little, there is some, is not, as we say in English, the comprimability, no? It's not comprimable. Yes, exactly. So the fluid, even oil, it's either high rigidity in terms of comprimability, but it's not infinite. So that means that there are some intrinsic elasticity in the system that is not so good in term for the accuracy. So here there are some advantages and disadvantages of electrical servo motor. So there are a widespread availability of a power supply. So everywhere you can find a current, current somewhere. So you don't need special plants. Are typically low cost and a wide range of products. There are many products that you can choose from a lot of producers. High power conversion efficiency, easy maintenance, and no pollution of work environment. There is not, they don't produce dust or stuff like that. Some limitation, burnout problem in static situation, because typically they are self-refrigerated by air, but this happens only if they move. Okay, the motion of the motor generate a flux of air that reduces the temperature. But if you stay in a steady state configuration, this does not happen, so you can have some burnout problems that can generate problems in terms of stop of the system if the weight is too high. There are special needs if you want to operate in flammable environments, okay? Because the motor can inject, the electricity in general can inject. So depends, for example, if you have to work where there are gases, possibility to have gases or carbon, any kind of material that is flammable, you have to protect your system, your robot, with special cages or jackets or stuff like that. Hydraulic servo motors, so there are no suffer of a burnout, as I said. The fluids itself used to refrigerate, stuff like that. So have excellent power to weight ratio, because the power generation of energy is far. You just need to put on the system the piston or the turbine plus the valve, so the weight, and they can generate enormous forces, enormous, with respect to electrical one. So you need an hydraulic power station, and this is costly. So if you have a lot of robots and you have only one central unit, you can spread the cost over several robots, and so you can find a balance. But if you need one robot, it's very costly to generate an hydraulic power supply unit for only for one robot. You spend too much. There are not so many products available, especially for robot application. There is a poor power conversion efficiency. And you need a lot of maintenance, okay? And there is a pollution working environment due to the oil leakages that typically exist. So there are some disadvantages about that. Okay, this is not... Power supply, okay, for the electrical servo motor, typically there is a transformator plus an uncontrolled bridge rectifier. For hydraulic servo motor, typically we have a primary motor that typically is a three-phase non-synchronous motor operating at constant speed, plus a stored hydraulic energy, plus filters, pressure valves, a lot of stuff. And this typically works at high pressure that are in the magnitude order of 100 atmospheres. So it's quite high pressure. So electrical drivers, so typically are or permanent magnet DC servo motors or brushless DC servo motor. The second category has a better way to torque ratio, and this is why typically are chosen on industrial robot manipulators. Also, here there are no are brushless, so the maintenance is zero. At the end, you don't need to maintain too much here and so on. Hydraulic servo motor. Okay, that's plus or minus brief introduction about servo motors. About sensors. So, as I said, we have to consider two different categories that are the proprioceptive sensor and the exteroceptive sensors. The proprioceptive in particular are joint position, joint velocity, and joint torque sensors. Okay, these are the sensors that typically are used to measure the state. A state of a mechanical system, its position and velocity. Okay, this fully complete the state of the system. In some special application, we can also need a joint torque, and I will explain after a while. Exteroceptive sensors are typically force torque sensor in the wrist of the robot that measure the interaction force and torques between the robot and the tool or the environment. Tactile sensors, that is will be needed to know if we grasped or not something, for example. Proximity sensors, range sensor, and vision sensors are typically used in industrial to compose industrial robot cell. The control scheme for so, position transducer, obviously we need two different types to measure linear and angular displacement, because if we have a linear actuation system, so a prismatic joint, we need to measure a translation. And instead, if we have a revolute joint, we need to measure an angle. Okay? So, in particular, the most diffused one are potentiometers, but suffers of temperature drift, also needs a lot of maintenance. Another possibility are linear variable differential transformers that are LVDT, that are very diffused, this one, or inductosim. These are for linear displacement. For angular displacement, typically we can use again potentiometers, or encoders that are very diffused, resolvers, or synchros that are all type of sensors that could be used in a robot manipulator. We'll give a look to each of these quickly. Only to the rotational one, the linear one are similar in some way. So the encoder, I don't know if you know how is made an encoder. Encoder is typically made by a plexiglass disc that has some segments, sectors transparent and some other not. And you have a number of sectors here. In this case, for example, we have four sectors with 16 segments, okay? And for each one of this level, we will put on one side a LED, an illuminator, and the opposite side a phototransistor. So it means that if we stay with a black position, there are no continuity in the light signal. If we have in the transparent one, there is continuity. So with the four transducer, generate a binary code that corresponds to the position of each of these segments. In particular, you can see that the binary code that has been used here is here shown. So each segment has a binary code that is unique and can provide us the position, the absolute position of the encoder with respect to a reference frame. Okay. So the drawback of this one is that if we want to have a higher resolution means that we need a lot of bits, 12, 16 bits, means that we need 12, 16 circular levels here. But we want that this should be miniaturized, so we have to compress a lot of stuff in a very compact way. All should be precise, and so the cost typically of these objects is very high. This is the absolute encoder. There is another way to generate an encoder, that is the incremental encoder. Another way that is simpler, with just two sectors in a quadrature, one with respect to another one, that as is shown here, plus a third level that is only used for the absolutization. In this case, what we measure is a relative displacement, not an absolute displacement, because if we measure this, for example, the position here, and we rotate this disk, okay, we can measure the number of changing of illumination. So here we have a front, here we have another front, a front. Each front corresponds to a specific angular displacement. So if we count 10 fronts, it means that we have moved over a certain angle. So it's an incremental value. So we need a counter that counts the number of variations of the signal to measure how it matches the angle that we rotated. If we use two in quadrature, we can also distinguish if we are rotating in clockwise or under clockwise direction. So in the counter we can sum or decrement the count and we can convert this in an angle. We also need an absolutization value, the third level, in a way that once that we encounter this, we know which is this position. Okay, this is just to absolutize this measurement. The resolver instead is another principle. Again, we are speaking about the measure of an angle, but the concept is different. So typically, in this case, we have a bobbin here, okay? This bobine is excitated by a sinusoidal modulated tension, and then we have two bobbins in quadrature, mechanically in quadrature, one with respect to another one. So it means that the magnetic flux will concatenate with both, but with a different function of this angle, one with the cosine, another one with the sine. Okay, this is mechanically. Okay. If one bobine is completely aligned with one, it is zero concatenated with another one. So it's what we generated here are two tensions with this formula. So are proportional to what we have in the origin bobbin plus a scale factor that depends non linearly with the cosine and sine function with the angle that we have here. Then we multiply these two functions digitally, the first one for the sine of an angle alpha, where alpha is another angle, and the second one with the cosine. This alpha is generated by this block that we will see in a while. What we achieved by making the difference between these two signals, so here we have cosine sine minus, and here we have plus sine cosine, the sum is again, this intensity for the sine of the difference of these two angles, okay, for the trigonometric properties. We amplify this. Then, this is modulated by this portant. We can demodulate in a synchronous way, so we remove this variable part here with the that is works that works with the frequency omega, and what we achieve here is a signal proportional to the sine of this angle error. Now, the sine of a small quantity is close to the quantity, no? If this error is small, this sine of this difference is very close to theta minus alpha. If we integrated this quantity, okay, what we achieved here is a value proportional to this in the integration of this. Now, supposing that theta is less than alpha, okay? So it means that here we reached a positive value. We integrate, this value increase. This value is used to generate alpha, so it means that alpha increase. If alpha increase, the error goes to zero. If if theta is lower than alpha, the quantity that arrives in this integrator is a negative value, so the integrator becomes negative or reduces its value. It means that alpha decrease, and so again the error goes to zero. So this loop, closed loop system is is like a tracker system of theta for the angle alpha. So alpha track theta, okay? So if we run this at high frequency, the error between theta and alpha becomes very small. So this means that here, the signal that we have here, alpha, at the end is almost equal to theta. So we generated a measurement of theta. And another interesting thing is that here we have an integrator, so it means that here we have a signal proportional to the velocity theta. So with the same machine, we generated simultaneously the measurement of the angle and also the measurement of the velocity theta. Okay, we did the same with only one sensor. Okay, and this is an electromechanical system. This is hybrid. There are a mechanical part plus an electronic part. This part here, the VCO is taking input attention and generate a sequence of impulse with a frequency that increase if the tension here increase, or decrease if the tension here decrease, okay? And this number will be go in a counter, and this counter generate is proportional to alpha, so in a very simple way. So it's a counter, and the output of this counter multiplied by factor is equal to alpha, and so we achieved this closed loop system in a very smart way. So these are the most diffused system to measure angles. To measure velocity, okay, one is the resolver, as I just said, that is also used to measure the velocity. Another possibility is to use the encoder. The encoder, if we use the encoder by measuring the frequency of the impulse that arrive, is proportional again to the angular velocity. It's another, so the encoder, by measuring by the frequency of the impulse, can provide us a measurement of the velocity. Another way, if we move very slowly, if we measure the time between two impulses, again is a measurement of the frequency. So if we move fast, it's better if we measure frequency of impulse. If we move slow, it's better to measure the period. Okay? So typically, if we want to use, we use both measurements, and we switch from one to another one at a certain threshold in a way to keep high the resolution of the system. But exist also specific system to measure sensors to measure velocity. One is the tachometer. DC tachometer is like a dynamo. It's very simple. It's a small motor, DC motor that generate. If you put in rotation, generate a tension that is proportional to the angular velocity. Very simple. Or otherwise, an AC tachometer that generate a sinusoidal value, and then we have to demodulate this signal, but the concept is not so different. Okay, this is for the mechanicals, on the mechanical side in position and velocity. For to measure the sensor, the force at the end effector, so in the wrist, we want to measure force and torque, we can use a special composition of strain gauges. I don't know if you know which is a strain gauge. A strain gauge is simply a resistor, okay, that is a filament that develops its length almost in one direction. So if we deformate in this along this direction, this mechanically, this resistor, the resistance, the value changes as well. So, and it's possible to demonstrate that there is, in a certain range, a linear relationship between the deformation and the value of the resistance. So if we apply this on a mechanical part, on a block, a mechanical block, and we try to deformate by applying a force, we can measure this deformation measuring the resistance. So we can perform an indirect measurement of the force that we are applying, measuring the deformation that a specific element is subject to, okay? And once that we apply this on a mechanical structure, typically we can use to measure the resistance a special configuration that is a Wheaton bridge to measure with a high accuracy this variation of these strain gauges. And here is the relationship of this configuration. Typically, the best configuration is to use four elements, two on the opposite side, so it means that one is compressed and another one is, which is the opposite of compression? Is exactly. So it means that one decrease and one increase the value. So it means that one increase and one decrease, we are unbalancing the bridge a lot. So we double the resolution of the system. And if we put another two in the same position, it means that if we have variations of temperature, on two on the top and two on the bottom is the same variation, it means that there is no unbalancing in the levels of tension. So we compensate automatically variations in terms of due to the temperature. So it's a temperature self-stabilized, and we double the accuracy. But we have to put four strain gauges, two on one side and two on the opposite side. Okay, if we want not to spend this 10 cents for this, you can put only a couple or only one. If you put only two, it's better to have one on the bottom and one on the top, in a way that we can compensate the temperature. If you use one, you have to compensate in somewhere the temperature. Obviously, it depends. If you have to create to weight a guy, a people, you need a resolution that probably is not needed to compensate too much the temperature. If you have to weight some stuff as a measurement, so you need to compensate, and so it depends. So, but these are typically the way to proceed. Now, which is the mechanical structure you typically used in a wrist of a robot manipulator? The most diffused one is the Malta cross structure that is here shown. So this is the arm. This is the part fixed to the arm. This internal part is the part fixed with the end effector. This internal part is connected to the robot through four parallelepipeds. On each side of this parallelepiped is placed a strain gauge. So we have eight strain gauges here, okay? So if we apply a force or a torque at the end effector, we generate deformations on all these strain gauges in general. And by matching this deformation through a calibration matrix with the force and torque, is possible to generate this measurement of the force and torque applied here. Notice that the deformation, if we apply the force here, we need to translate this force in the force applied here. And we can do this with this formula that I showed you before, that changes the reference frame of an applied force, because we need to know which is the force applied here. Then, if we have all this, each of these arrow here correspond to a measurement of the deformation of a strain gauge along this direction. So this is the vector of all these measurements of strain gauges. Here we have a matrix, and here we have the forces and the torque along the axis. For example, which is the sensors, the strain gauges, that measure the deformation along this direction? If we can see are W2, W8, W6 and W4. If we go in this matrix, so FZ, we have a zero here because W1 is orthogonal to this direction, that there is no deformation. So it's zero. Then we have a coefficient that we have to estimate that is proportional to W2, zero because W3 is orthogonal, a coefficient to W4 and so on. So we can see that on this row, we are four coefficients that weights the measurements of these four strain gauges. If we want to measure the deformation along Fx, we can see that only these two strain gauges can measure this deformation, W3 and W7. In fact, here we have one here and one here. All the others are zero. So in this way, we construct this matrix. Then we can calibrate this matrix by performing a lot of measurements, and by measuring this with another sensor that is used to calibrate our sensor. Okay, so we can generate a regressor and we can just calibrate this matrix.